a look at the unbeaten record. 29 wins, 24 KOs. Most recently, significant victories over Obed Sullivan and the veteran Jesse Ferguson. And as you can see, Rahman's chances for a knockout diminish considerably when you get past the first two rounds. And now let's go up to ring announcer Mark Biro for the official introduction.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Miccosukee Indian Gaming near Miami, Florida, for an evening of World Championship Boxing on HBO Sports. Under the promotion of Cedric Kushner Promotions, the matchmaker is Eric Botcher. Tonight's bouts are under the auspices of the Florida State Athletic Commission, the chairman, Alvin Goodman, vice chairman, Dr. Jack Gugino, commissioners Terry James, Eric Riley, and Aleida Waldman. Ring officials assigned by the Florida State Athletic Commission, your ringside physicians are Chief Physician Dr. Alan Fields and Dr. Ramon Garcia Septien. Your timekeeper is the cheerful Carmine Chirichella. And counting for the knockdowns at the bell, the alternate referee, Jorge Alonso. Ladies and gentlemen, Cedric Kushner Promotions in association with Main Events Monitor, HBO Sports, and Budweiser. This Bud's for You presents 12 rounds for the IBA Intercontinental and USBA Heavyweight Championships. Mandatory box off. Your ring officials assigned by the International Boxing Federation and United States Boxing Association, IBF and USBA President Robert W. Lee. Your judges at ringside are from Chicago, Illinois, Mike Gliena, from Arlington, Virginia, Sheila Harmon Martin, and from Miami, Florida, Rocky Young. Your referee for this event, from Jacksonville, Florida, Teles Asimenios. Introducing now the principals first, in the blue corner to my right, wearing the black trunks with the white accessories. He weighs in at 224 and a half pounds. His professional record reads 32 victories, one defeat, 27 wins coming by way of knockout. He hails from the Isle of Samoa and now boxes out of South Auckland, New Zealand. Former WBC Continental America's heavyweight champion, David Tua. Tua. His opponent in the red corner, wearing the black trunks, red and white trim. He weighs in at 234 and a half pounds. He is undefeated in 29 professional bouts, 24 wins coming by way of knockout. He boxes out of Baltimore, Maryland, the IBF Intercontinental and USBA Heavyweight Champion, Haseem the Rock Rahman. Rahman, 12 rounds for the IBF Intercontinental and USBA Heavyweight Championships.
One corner man. Take your shirt off. Take your shirt off.
Gentlemen, you have received instructions in the dressing rooms. Obey my commands at all times. Protect yourselves at all times. You have any questions? This is... The belt is positioned properly, so from here down is a low blow. I know we had some concerns. I wish you good luck. May God bless you. Shake hands, please.
I hope the referee exercises more control during the fight than he did just now in the introductions when he allowed the fighters and all of their handlers to approach each other at center ring for the introductions.
Fascinating strategic confrontation. Can Rahman outbox the quicker, vastly more experienced Tua? Can Tua overpower the bigger, heavier Rahman.
Can either of them deal with the other's big punch?
It's a wonderful set of questions for the two heavyweights to bring into the ring. Just to reiterate what Larry Merchant said in the opening, Larry Merchant's choice as the most significant fight of 1998 in any weight class, because so much is at stake for the two young heavyweights. Tua to the body with the left hook, Rahman with a right to the body, and up top.
Watch for Tua to come with that overhand right over Rockman's jab if he keeps jabbing low.
Rahman believes his big advantage in the fight is a superior jab. He thinks that he should be able to outbox Tua as the result of it, and he's landing the jab early.
And that should be his best weapon if he uses it properly.
Another question. Can Tua force Rahman to fight at a faster pace? Uncomfortable for him. Rahman loves to fight at a snail's pace and measure himself round to round.
And that seems to be what Tua is doing early. He's trying to push the issue, make Rahman fight early.
Rahman already being warned for pushing off with the elbow, a persistent habit of his. Later, you'll see him lean all over Tua when Tua forces his way in. There's a sharp right hand to the top of Tua's head by Rahman, and Tua sneaks his left hook behind Rockman's guard.
Rahman can continuously throw that jab like he's doing it, Jim. It is going to cause a problem for Tua.
I think the jab has already slowed down Tua's advance and his desire to get in there and pressure Rahman. Another sharp right hand over the top by Rahman. Tua's left hook partially blocked. Tua's head pretty still as he sizes Rahman up, and Rahman taking advantage of the still head to land the jab and occasional right hands. If anybody has made a strategic statement in round one, so far it's Haseem Rahman. Double left hook by Tua, Rahman with a counter left of his own. Haseem promised us in fighter meetings yesterday that he would finally unveil a left hook tonight. A punch that those of us who've watched him several times have been calling for as an addition to his arsenal.
So far, all he needs to unveil is that left jab right there. That's doing everything it needs to do. It's keeping Tua at bay. It's keeping him off guard. It won't let Tua set up the big punches so far.
The early tempo of the fight favoring Rahman. Tua finally unleashing a flurry in the closing seconds of round one.
That's a real nice round, son. Real nice round. That's boxing tonight. Look at the focus. What I need you to do,
come back and relax.
Relax and keep that jab in his face. Now look at me. If you can beat this guy for 12 rounds with moving in a jab just by changing a little direction, take some deep heat.
You got the right hand up high.
Got his high right.
Hit him on the shoulder when he throw that hook.
You hear it?
Don't aim at him.
Intimidate this guy. Hurt this guy.
I want you to throw fast punches with this guy.
Now, come on. Let's hurt this guy.
Double jab. Stepping up with the jab. Snap the jab. Do not lay that jab out there, okay? And roll. Then hit him on the arm with that hook.
Let's go. All
right? Let's pick up the punch count.
Don't jump in.
Sense of urgency in Tua's corner from Lou Duva and Ronnie Shields after an ineffective first round by Tua. Rahman landing 20 of 43 jabs. That was the story of the round. And Haseem comes out firing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 jabs and a right hand to begin round two.
One problem is when a guy's throwing a good jab, you should attack his jab. Counter every time he sticks a jab out, and this can discourage his jab. Tua is not doing this, and if he doesn't, he's going to make it an easy night for Rahman.
I think Rahman has showed unusual poise. We've never seen him quite this calm. He seems to know exactly what he wants to do, and he's doing it.
Rahman with a new trainer, Chuck McGregor. He first became familiar with McGregor when McGregor trained Obed Sullivan against him a year and a half ago in the Apollo Theater in New York. Now he's in McGregor's stable of 7 or 8 heavyweights out there in Arizona.
inside, he's still keeping that left hand a little low. So if Tua did throw the open hand right, it's a possibility that it could land, but he's not throwing it.
Only seen a couple of overhand rights from Tua. Rockman saying disdainfully of Tua, hey, he's a two-punch fighter. He throws an overhand right and a left hook, occasionally an uppercut. I can deal with all that. When you can't deal with it is when Tua hurts you with one of those punches. And more it looks to me, Roy, as though if he hurts Rockman, he's going to have to get to the body first to do it.
There he threw overhand right and landed the left hook because of landing that overhand right first.
Tua starting to dig to the body. Logic tells you he must chop Rockman tight down, with the body up.
There goes the overhand right I was talking about.
Absolutely.
If Rockman has that left hand low, he has to go the overhand right.
Rockman with a double left hook.
Good left hook. Good looking left hook.
Rockman has his right hand pinned to the right side of his face and using his left hand to win the fight.
Tua that time leading with the left hook and landed it.
The right hand pinned to the side of his face is keeping him in the fight because it's keeping him from getting hit with that big left hook.
Exactly what I was saying. In other words, he's saying to Tua, you're not going to beat me with your left hook. You're going to have to find another way. I don't know that you have another way.
He's taking Tua's most effective punch away from him.
Well, it's no mystery that when you fight David Tua, you got to take away the left hook. And Rockman doing an effective job of it, scoring with his own jab, adding multiplicity to his punch output. Terrific first two rounds for Haseem Rockman.
Combination I want. The next combination I want is the overhand right, hook to the body, hook to the head, then back to the body.
He's coming in with
Don't get tied up in that. Don't get tied up in that. Stay with me.
Stay relaxed.
Don't let go of it.
Close your eyes and listen.
Keep the jab coming. Work him with the jab and movement. Boxing for a couple rounds. You're out pointing him. You're busting his face up. Keep boxing him and popping.
Long spot in this round.
Go ahead, Larry.
I was just to say that Rockman took some good shots from Tua in that round. If he can take Tua's shots, he could make his own fight here.
And you see the Luttleman card. Rockman the winner in both of the first two rounds there. I was just going to say, Haseem Rockman, throughout most of his fights with Obed Sullivan and Jesse Ferguson, struggled to throw more than 40 or 50 punches a round. In round two tonight, 94 Rockman punches. That's the kind of number you would expect to see from Tua if Tua were fighting his fight.
And that jab is doing a lot of neutralization here, Jim. It's neutralizing everything that Tua wants to do.
And as Chuck McGregor pointed out between rounds to his fighter, Tua's face already beginning to pump and show the effects of the repeated Rockman jab. Tua going inside and getting shoulder to shoulder with Rockman. And this is what tends to happen in the latter stages of a Rockman fight when he tires and quits throwing his jab with as much regularity. Good straight right cross by Rockman, and Tua gets to the body with a left hook.
Rockman's respect for the left hand of Tua even shows in the fact that he's really not letting the right hand go. When we've seen him against lesser opponents, he throws that right hand almost recklessly.
Overhand right landed for Tua. Rockman never moved the right hand guard from the side of his face so that Tua couldn't come back with the left hook.
Yeah, Jim, but he still has to keep that left hand up, does Rockman, or else Tua's going to land that overhand right more often.
Well, if he can do what he's done for the first 2 2/3 rounds all the way through, it'll be an easy win. But stamina has been a question for Rahman in the past.
Yeah, because he had the left hand up last round, but he dropped it again early this round already.
Tua with a combination, head and body.
That was the combination he was asked for in the corner. It's remarkable to me that 2 minutes into the round, he could still remember those instructions.
Maybe he's trying to wear his opponent down because he knows that Rockman usually tires in a long fight.
Lou Duva and Ronnie Shields have a love affair with David Tua. There's perhaps no fighter in their entire group whom they personally revere and have more affection for than David Tua. And part of it is because he is such a devoted learner day by day in the gym.
And these body shots are going to prove to be effective later on in this fight if it continues to go, Jim.
You saw Tua's late round comebacks against both David Izanrete, now David Izon, and against Ibeabuchi. The one against Ibeabuchi fell short, and still to come tonight, Floyd Mayweather Jr., world champion now at 130 pounds, and the man who preceded last week's Fernando Vargas victory to become the first from the 1996 Olympic team to win a world championship. Vargas was the second. David Reed somewhere down the road, along with several other Olympians who are getting into position. Tonight's Mayweather opponent, Angel Manfredi. Astonishing in the current business practices of the sport that he would have chosen to fight Manfredi right away upon gaining the title.
Right hand, when you close, hit him with the body shot. Hit him with the uppercut. Come back with the hook right hand, okay? A lot of overhand right
there. Other than that, after you jab, use your legs a little more. Relax. That way he's got a reach for that body shot.
Close your ass. Get down, man.
Here you see the combination that Tua threw at the end of the fight. Left, right to the head, left to the body. At this point, Rockman is landing roughly an average of 20 jabs per round to Tua's three. If you recall, before the fight, we said he had to extend his advantage with the jab to hold off Tua. He is doing exactly that.
And landing 20, but just as important, throwing 44 per round. A high jab output, keeping Tua busy defending himself.
Tua fights the hardest way, the wars of attrition.
Overhand right lands for Tua.
Tua has never been cut and has never been down.
Left eye seems to be swelling the clothes a little bit, Tua.
Right hand lands for Rahman, and again, jab, jab, jab. Keeping Tua on the defensive. Rahman dominating the fight with the stick. George Foreman sitting at home tonight always says, Roy, it's an easy sport if you have a jab.
If you have a good jab, when the time comes, you can make your job extra easy.
Now that he has made Tua, impaled him literally on the end of his jab, he's starting to throw that right hand a little bit more.
Stop, babe!
They talk about Tua having a tick-tock defense, supposedly to roll his head from side to side. But right now, he's just getting clocked.
Yeah, because he's stopping one jab and getting caught with the second one every single time.
Rahman releases the right hand and then immediately pins it to his cheek, looking for the left hook coming back. Tua, who was active to the body in the last round, has not been able to observe Ronnie Shields' instructions to go to the ribcage in this round. Now he tries to get to the body. If there's been one dramatic change in the heavyweight division over the past 10 years, it is size. Nowadays, David Tua at 220-some-odd pounds is a smaller heavyweight. Haseem Rahman is the norm at 230-plus. Guys like Lennox Lewis and Michael Grant, they're the future, pushing 250 pounds of athletic muscle.
Yeah, heavyweights are heavy now.
Very.
Oh, good right hand by Rahman.
Terrific combination by Rahman, hurting Tua as he stands in his corner and counter-punches brilliantly past the Tua attack.
far a flawless performance by Rockman.
Look, you can't slow up. You gave away that will.
And the beginning of an abrasion around the left eye of Tua.
You got to step it up now, okay?
Just as Roy Jones said.
Hit you with a jab, you're making it with a jab.
You got to stay low,
man. Jab. Stay low. Get down. Get down. Get down. Move that head.
Come up hand. Throw right hand, lead it. Come back with a hook. Rock, look at me. Focus, son. I need you to use your feet a little more. And I don't want you against the ropes where he can pin you and rake your body and try to come back up over.
Rockman looks like a different fighter from the one we saw against Obed Sullivan. Poised, patient, and now when he has Tua impaled on his left jab, letting loose a fusillade of hard punches to the head.
And in round four, Larry, Rockman, seen by CompuBox as having thrown 99 punches. That used to be three rounds for Rockman. Harold, how do you have it so far?
Jim, 20 to 36, four rounds to nothing, Haseem Rahman. You know, Jim, I tell you, when David Tua takes that step inside, okay, the racket hits him with a left jab, but then he drops that right hand on him, and that's a punch that's really doing a lot of damage. Watch David Tua. He'll take one step inside, and the rock will drop the right hand that murders Tua. Also, watch Rockman's defense. He's blocking all the blue shots. One other thing real quick, the ropes are loose. Be careful. These guys could really come through these ropes.
Which makes the size of the heavyweights now a bigger factor for the announcers at ringside. Tough catch if Rockman comes through.
Rockman is basically having his way here with David Tua, and this is not good for Tua because people don't realize it takes just as much out of you to absorb punches as it does to throw them.
Though Tua was coming up and knocking everybody out, his limitations didn't look terribly daunting because his strengths were so strong. The vicious left hook, the head bobbing defense, the relentlessness with which he came at you. But now you see him trying to do it against a bigger, stronger guy. And this is a major change for David and a tough obstacle.
And it's getting worse for him because now he's losing the fight inside and outside.
And it's interesting you should mention that because I was just thinking that Rockman had sparred with Abe Abuchi, who did a similar job on Tua, holding him off inside, stepping outside, and beating him from outside.
Tua needs something big to happen for him sometime soon here, or he's going to be in a bad situation.
Hey, Beyabuchi did everything that Rockman is doing offensively, but Beyabuchi didn't defend himself as well as The Rock is. I mean, Tua was able to get to Beyabuchi and hit him a lot. He's not able to do that with Rockman because of what's coming back, like that right there.
And every time he lands a good punch, The Rock lands it right back. 3-4-1. The Rock seems to be confident in his condition, too.
He's fighting an intelligent fight. Intelligence runs in the family. He's got a brother in medical school. His father was an engineer. He's just been in the ring for 5 or 6 years and showing us some real quality stuff tonight.
Family wasn't at first certain that they were happy with Haseem's choice in becoming a boxer, but he was at the time the one member of the family who was getting in trouble and falling short of his potential. So they said, well, if he's devoted to this, let's let him go with it. Look what he's done. Just look what he's done.
Let me have him. Let me talk to him. Come on. Your box is beautiful. I don't want you in a fight. Come on. Give me some deep breaths and relax. If you box him and use your feet in some angles and movement for a round, you can win the round on points.
That's what you try to win on points.
Get some distance. I would have won. You're looking real good, but I need you to create distance. And when he starts that quick head movement, just slide off. Just slide off. Keep moving and jabbing and stepping short angles. Don't lay inside. I don't want an inside fight. You hear me? Mm-hmm. What I want, quick sticks, keep your composure, and don't get... Okay, real
second time.
Everything off that...
Second time.
winner of this fight will be installed by one of the three governing bodies, the IBF, as the mandatory challenger for the winner of the bout between Lennox Lewis and Evander Holyfield. One never knows what will happen to title belts, which will be kept, which will be dropped into garbage pails, which will be stripped, etc., etc. But somehow or another, the winner of this fight is supposed to get a ticket to a heavyweight championship opportunity. And in the first five rounds, it's been all Haseem Rahman. By CompuBox numbers, Tua landed 28 of 50 punches in round five. That's his best round so far. But still, Rahman doubled his punch output, throwing 99 himself. That's what happens when you work behind the jab and keep pumping it. About the moment, Roy, when I can imagine George, the consummate heavyweight himself, sitting here saying David Tua needs to dispense with the fight plan, go inside and roughhouse, do anything to change the tempo of the fight.
He at least needs to punch, but now every time he sticks his arms out, he's getting caught with a big punch, so he's afraid to punch as much. But he has to punch. That's the only chance that he has.
Rahman is fighting is a genuine revelation in the boxing world, where David Tua has won some real respect. Rahman has never shown this kind of quality before.
There you see him smart enough. Rahman was smart enough to walk Tua back to the center of the ring so he doesn't start out against the ropes, because his corner doesn't want him against the ropes. Tua is just not looking to punch enough.
Tua trying to slip the jab, as Ronnie Shields has urged him to do. This round fought at a relatively measured pace. And again, historically, that's what Rahman likes. Although he's been setting a fast pace tonight, he's comfortable when the punch count slows, and he just leans all over guys and uses his big body to bluff them. Still to come tonight, following the heavyweight battle, Angel Manfredi, trying to win a 130-pound world championship against Floyd Mayweather Jr. Angel, who is given to dreams and visions, says that when he went to church last Sunday, he had a vision in which an angel placed Mayweather's championship belt on his waist, and he wept because he knew that God was telling him that the title was already his.
Oh, that looping right hand. When he throws that looping right hand, shake him good, but shake it out here. And come back with a short hook. And when he throws the hook, catch it.
Close your eyes and listen.
But I don't want you in there fighting. Give me.
Rahman has been very comfortable on the ropes. There you see.
Seconds out.
He threads a nice left hook right through to his defense.
And moves away rather than pausing to admire his work.
Although that was to his best round, I thought.
Well, more and more it appears that David Tua will need a second half of the fight comeback. Haseem Rahman using a well-constructed plan to outbox Tua during the first six rounds of the scheduled 12-round fight.
Body blows. He seems to be wincing now when he catches one of the big body blows.
David Tua just had his best minute of the fight. Landed two big right hands over the top. Now Rahman jabbing him as Tua tries to come in with no head movement. And a jab his way in.
Rockman could be showing a sign of fatigue here, Jim.
That's been his history. He tires in the second half of the fight. Tua lands the left hook to Rockman's jaw after first pounding one against the side of his neck.
But Tua needs to go to work right now. This is the big moment he's been waiting for. He needs some more big things to happen, but he can't get careless. He has to take it one round at a time. Now Rockman's brought the hands back up, so he's not as open as he was. Body shots may be hurting two or two.
Rockman with an excellent uppercut backs two away and moves off the ropes. And goes back to the steaming jab. A stiletto in the Miami Knight for the big heavyweight, Haseem Rockman.
Showing great poise and great conditioning here.
A brief Tua rally in the middle of the seventh round has been blunted again by the Rockman jab.
I think the body shots keep taking everything Tua has away from him.
Now Tua lands a right hand to the chest. And comes back with a left hook up top. Rockman countering with a left hook of his own.
This is a heavyweight fight.
You're losing a fight, and you're losing it pretty good. The only way you're going to win is by knockout. And the only way you're going to knock this guy out is you got to throw punches. You just can't look at the guy. Get close and let him grab you. You can't grab him.
Here we see Tua, left hand a little bit long. That one right on.
Seconds out.
And here we see Rockman come back with his own left. You heard Lou Duva in the corner. I don't recall hearing this early in the fight. A 12-round fight at the end of the seventh round, and Duva is saying, you have to win by a knockout. This is the earliest knockout call I can ever recall.
And
Letterman gave the round to David Tua. Go ahead, Roy.
I think the reason he's telling him this is because he knows that he's not going to outpoint Rockman in a long fight. So he wants him to start trying to knock Rockman out right now.
Well, and I think beyond that, if there's a chance still for David to gain a decision, the only way he can gain the decision is by stepping up his punch output and fighting more furiously with more activity. So Duva's appellation to it works on both levels. A, it gives him a chance to score the knockout he might need. B, it would help him to have a chance to win a decision because he's not going to get it fighting this way. He wants desperation out of the fighter. He wants a more breakneck style. Why it's hard for Tua to do what's asked for.
That jab has been a very discouraging tool to David Tua tonight.
It's been the story of the fight.
It's like having a good running game in football. When things are not going exactly the way you want, you just hand the ball off and you make a first down.
Well, plus, as Floyd Mayweather Jr. said in our meeting yesterday, a good jab is your offense and your defense.
Two good body punches by Tua.
Samoan drums at ringside, trying to build the feverish energy for David Tua. The Samoan by way of New Zealand.
Right here is where David Tua is supposed to be doing work at, but he doesn't. He's so tired from absorbing all the punches until he just doesn't do anything inside anymore.
Tua says that at the end of his workout every day, he likes to sit down in front of a mirror for about a half hour and just stare into the mirror, visualizing his hopes and dreams and how he responds to them. If he looked in a mirror right now, he wouldn't like the way Haseem Rahman has made his jab look. And here's a momentary pause to redo the tape around Rahman's glove. Tua, who's thrown only 23 punches in the round, despite Lou Duba's urging that he must go wild, has plenty of time to think about it as they work on Rahman. This is the longest glove tape delay I can remember.
Tua hasn't looked to his corner yet, but he should look to his corner, and they should tell him that he needs to go right back out there, get close to Rahman, and start working on the inside.
What's going on in there?
Well, what's going on is that in round eight of a 12-round fight, or I should say, yeah, right here in round eight of a 12-round fight, Haseem Rahman just got a welcome one-and-a-half-minute rest. For a guy who's had a tendency to tire down the stretch, it couldn't have worked out better.
Why is David Tua holding on the inside? David Tua should be the guy that's busy on the inside.
Because he doesn't like the way he's getting hit. Fights change when fighters don't like getting hit. And tonight, Tua is absorbing a lot of leather. Right to the body by Rahman. Another relatively slowly paced round. January 26th, Real Sports with Bryant Gumbel returns. It's actually January 25, excuse me. Among the stories, we'll investigate offshore gambling operations, which take in millions of dollars in illegal sports bets. We'll look at the grueling and often frustrating life of an NFL assistant coach. We'll examine a controversial study which asserts that one out of every five National Football League players has a criminal background. Real Sports with Bryant Gumbel, premiering Monday, January 25 at 10 o'clock Eastern and Pacific.
You got to let both hands go with this guy.
This guy's tired.
Hey, this guy, you can knock him out. If you throw punches.
Ain't no certain punches I want you to throw. I just want you to throw punches. I don't care what you hit him.
Hit him. Power on the right hand. He's leaning into a hook.
All right, jab.
Short right hand.
Get out of here.
Put your power on the hook on the inside.
Second count.
Come on.
Two-thirds of the way through this fight.
Second count.
Haseem Rahman is establishing himself along with Michael Grant as the best young heavyweight in the world. But it ain't over until it's over.
Yeah, but you're right. At this stage, his status is skyrocketing and Tua's is diminishing. Harold, how do you have it through eight?
Tonight it's 78-74, 6 rounds to 2, Haseem Rahman. I gave round 6 and 7 to David Tua because he got inside and the rock stopped jabbing, I tell you the truth. But you know, Jim, maybe I'm imagining this, but it's very strange. If you watch Rahman real close like I watch him, half the time he ain't looking at Tua. He's looking all over the place. Watch his head. Watch his eyes. He looks at me, looks at you, looks at the corner. I'm telling you, if he takes his eyes off of Tua once too many times, he's going to get whacked.
Well, maybe he's got some kind of special peripheral vision because he seems to be controlling the fight defensively as well as offensively.
Actually, what I think he's doing is he's watching Tua's shoulders. He looks like he's looking over the top of Tua, but he sees Tua's shoulders. So he can tell when Tua's going to throw a big punch. Whichever shoulder dips or starts to come at him, he dips to that side to avoid the punch.
Big, big right hand by Tua.
And Tua's quicker with the right hand. He has less of a tendency to telegraph that overhand right. When he wants to throw his big left hook, he's got a major tendency to dip to that side and let you know it's coming.
And that's what Rahman knows.
But if Rahman can take a really good punch like that without showing any signs of fatigue or hurt, you have to wonder what, if anything, Tua can do to change this.
The only thing that can change it, Larry, is the element of surprise. You have to catch him with one of those big punches when he's not expecting the big punch. That could change everything.
Well, I think it's going to have to be the right hand over the top, Roy, because more and more it appears the left hook has been blunted here. Another Rahman flurry, and Tua not throwing. Lou Duva sitting at ringside has a sick look on his face as he watches his heavyweight David Tua reduced to target practice part of the time by Haseem Rahman when Rahman elects to throw his jab. A good body shot by Tua.
One good punch, though, it's 10 seconds before he throws another good punch. Oh, oh.
Oh, boy.
That punch
into the round
landed immediately after the bell, and Rahman is seriously hurt, wobbling back to his corner. Lou Duva is in the middle of the ring, battling with the referee, and I have no idea why. The bell rang.
His fighter got the clear shot.
Here it is. That right, and that's the one. Just as the referee was moving in to separate them at the bell.
That first punch hurt Tua too, though. I mean, hurt
Rahman.
I thought it set him up for the second punch.
That first punch did hurt Rahman.
This is a real test for Rahman.
All right, 1 minute after the left hook that exploded off the cheek of Haseem Rahman, David Tua gets a chance to try to capitalize.
And Larry, like I told you, the element of surprise.
Fight getting closer on the Letterman card. Tua going to work. Slashing to the body with rights and lefts. Rahman in trouble. And the referee's going to stop it. Stop the fight.
I believe that is a very bad stoppage.
I totally agree. That's as premature as any stoppage can be in a heavyweight fight.
You can recall at the beginning of this fight, I said, is this referee going to be able to control what happened? Yes, Rahman was getting banged around.
Yeah, but these are heavyweights.
These are heavyweights. He was ahead in the fight. He had earned the benefit of the doubt to be given a chance.
What do you think, Roy?
I think what Larry said is very, very true. The guy, you have to give the guy an opportunity. He worked too hard for too long for you to step in and stop him. He wasn't getting hit repeatedly. He had control of himself. He was getting caught with good punches, but you still have to give him the benefit of the doubt.
Well,
he's been working too hard and too long.
That makes three of us, gentlemen. I think this is a rank injustice, which isn't to say that Tua wasn't continuing the rally and might not have gotten it done at some logical line.
What makes it a particular injustice, Jim, is he was hit after the bell in the previous round. He clearly had not fully recovered. And then he was taking a barrage. But I don't think that he was so far gone that he didn't have an opportunity to restore himself.
You only hope that Haseem Rahman's career doesn't suffer unwarrantedly as the result of this loss. And the Tua recognizes how fortunate he is if, in fact, the IBF follows through and makes him the mandatory challenger for the winner of the bout between Lewis and Holyfield.
You know, I've often thought of David Tua as being 5'10" tall, 5'10" wide, and 5'10" deep. He is deep. And to come back from the kind of beating he was taking through that fight, we have to give him credit. We've seen him do this type of thing before. You really can't discourage him.
Well, he has as much heart as any heavyweight.
Yes, he does. That was a very beautiful fight by both of these fighters. But one thing you have to know, Jim, sometimes the IBF and other governing bodies will demand a rematch when they see that there has been injustice. So hopefully these two fighters will come back and get to do this again, because both fighters fought a brilliant fight. It's not the fighter's fault that it happened this way.
Absolutely not. And you know, not to take anything away from David Tua, who deserves credit for the moxie he showed in continuing to come back and spotting his opportunity. But if he gets the title shot and Rockman goes back in the shuffle as the result of that, that would be unfair. So let's take another look at the end of the fight. And clearly, Roy, Tua was doing the damage.
Oh, yes. Tua had him. He was hitting him with some good punches. He hadn't dropped him yet. He was catching him. But as you see, he's fighting back. Not many of the punches are very clean punches. He's still ducking punches. He's still very clear. He sees exactly what's going on. He's not giving up. He was slipping punches there.
That is not a heavyweight fight stoppage situation. Sorry. Here it is at regular speed. You'll see what kind of damage Tua was doing. But you cannot say that Rockman was stunned or was out of it. He was in trouble, but he wasn't down and he wasn't out.
You're right. He was in trouble, but he wasn't down and he wasn't out. He wasn't down and he wasn't out.
But a comeback victory for David Tua, who showed you a lot of what he was made of as he managed to reverse circumstances in a bout in which most everything was going against him.
And he did exactly what I would have did, Jim. Once you get that referee close to watching, Tua did exactly what I would have did. He turned it on, and you hope that the referee will come in and stop it, because this is your chance to try to gain back everything you've lost in that fight. So I don't blame Tua. I would have done the same thing, because you know the referee wants to protect the guy. The referee is not doing this out of spite. He's just trying to look out for the other opponent.
Absolutely right.
Tua was very smart in going ahead and launching that attack the way he did.
And he sealed the deal with his trademark weapon. He may telegraph that left hook, but when he lands it, it makes its point.
Yes, it does.
All right, let's go to ring announcer Mark Barrow for the official particulars on this one.
The time, 35 seconds of the 10th round. The winner by tactical knockout and new IBF Intercontinental and USBA heavyweight champion, David Tua.
Final punch stat numbers continue to reflect Rahman's dominance of the fight, landing 106 more punches than Tua, throwing nearly twice as many. Tua landed at the higher connect percentage, but Rahman's jab was clearly the tactical weapon of consequence in the fight. 144 out of 357 jabs to 17 of 98 for Tua. It was a landslide. It gave Rockman the tactical advantage that he had used, we presume, to build up a lead on the scorecards. In power punches, however, Tua was sort of altering the picture a little bit, landing more than Rockman and at a much higher rate. And ultimately, Tua's power punches spelled the difference as they persuaded the referee to stop the fight. And Larry Merchant stands by with referee Telus Asimenios.
All right, thank you very much, Jim. Why did you stop the fight?
Larry, the guy could not defend himself on the ropes. He was taking shots on his head nonstop. I didn't have a choice. We don't have a standing eight count in the state of Florida. I advise the fighters, if they are in the same situation, go down in one knee to get a standing eight count, to get an eight count.
When did you advise them to go to a knee?
I advised them before the fight in their dressing rooms, both fighters, because we don't have, we're watching here. And
so you're saying that he should have taken a knee and then
right
he could have survived.
Right here, I think.
You see, but none of those punches, that punch landed, but that punch didn't land. I mean, only one of those last three or four punches landed flush.
Larry, from what I was seeing, the punch was landing. At one point, the ropes held him from going down.
Could you call, if the ropes were keeping him from falling down, couldn't you therefore call that a knockdown?
Yes, you can. Indeed, you can. However, he was squatting on his thighs too, and I didn't know if he's, you know, it was not very clear right here. You see him, the ropes barely hold.
He was sitting on the middle straight. You could conceivably have called that a knockdown.
He took three and four, five, six punches on the jaw unanswered.
All right, so that your feeling is, despite the fact that he appeared to be winning the fight and even controlling the fight, that barrage of punches put him too much in danger.
He didn't look, you know, when I saw his face, he looked a little bit dazed on me.
What about the punch at the end of the previous round that came immediately after the bell?
Well, I heard the bell ringing, and the same time a punch was flying. So it was right after the, seemed like after the bell, but, I mean, it was impossible to stop a punch like that.
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Larry.
All right, Jim.
Okay, and before we go back up to the ring to talk to the winner, David Tua, let's take a look at the scorecards through that point in the bout, which will show you what we expected to see. Haseem Rahman leading in the bout, 89-87. 89-82, he had won the fight on Harmon Martin's card. 89-82, he had won the fight on the third judge's card. So Haseem Rahman, to all intents and purposes, had already claimed a decision in the bout at the time when the referee stopped it in favor of Tua. So let's go back to Larry now with Samoan-born, New Zealand-raised David Tua, heavyweight contender.
All right, thank you very much, Jim. Congratulations, David. First, did the punch that landed at or just after the bell at the end of the previous round set up the victory?
First of all, for Tyler Tua, when we're in Talonga, I'd like to thank God for giving me the strength and the courage to go through it and take care of business tonight. And only that, first and foremost, I thank Dino, all the people at Main Events.
David, let's talk about
for working
the fight.
This fight out. I thank Ronnie, the sparring partner, Sam Hampton, and Tim Knight for giving me the opportunity. Yeah, you're right, Larry. You know, I knew it was going to come because, you know, every time he was setting that left hand, left jab out there, he was coming on with that right hand, and he was putting everything into it. And I knew that the more I make him miss, the more tired I was going to get. And the sooner or later, I knew it was going to catch up. And as you know, when I was getting inside him, he was hardly doing nothing. You know, I knew he was breathing a little bit
harder. But he seemed to be controlling and even dominating the fight to the point where at the end of the seventh round, Lou Duva was saying, you have to knock him out.
I did just that.
You did. All right. Let's see if we can get a look at the end of the fight, David, we'll take a look at that final fuselage. This is at the end of round nine, and that was the punch that really, he seemed to relax when the bell rang, and that's when you caught him.
Ronnie said to go in there and just punch, you know, punch with, you know.
Did you think he was helpless on the ropes?
Sure, I knew it. Like I said, he was starting to slow down. His pace was starting to slow down. And he was starting to drop his hand lower when I was getting inside.
He had been sort of controlling you with his jab. Did you feel that you were out of it in the first half of the fight and that it was just too hard to get inside him?
Sure, you know, it was pretty frustrating at times. You know, at time I thought I was going to make a miss, but, you know, he controlled the fight with his jab. But I knew I had confidence in my fitness. Sooner or later, I knew I was going to catch up with him.
You did. Once again, thank you, David Tua, and congratulations. And we'll talk to Rahman just in a moment. Here he comes, Haseem Rahman. Haseem, you were in full control of the fight, it seemed, until he caught you with a punch at the end of the ninth round when you seemed to relax for a moment when the bell rang. Is that an accurate portrayal of what happened?
Well, I thought the bell had already rung, but maybe I'm mistaken. But when you got two punches in the ring, people bound to get buzzed from time to time in a 12-round fight. This is a championship eliminator bout. You're not supposed to rob the champion in a fight like this. I mean, if you look at the replay, he hit me with some shots, but he was missing some shots. I was coherent. I was still making him miss punches, and I was punching back.
Let me ask you this.
And I'm 29 wins with one robbery. And do you think it was a fair?
All right, let's take a look at the end of the ninth round, and you is right. Describe what happened.
Punch after the bell. A good punch. Yeah, he's a puncher.
When you came out, out for the next round, were you still buzzed from that?
I was not buzzed. I mean, the man is a puncher. I mean, man, I'm the champion. I deserve the respect as a champion. The man should not have jumped in there. It wasn't like he was hitting me and my hands was down. I was still defending myself. And it's a championship 12-round fight. You're going to start the fight in the 10th round?
All right, let's take a look, and you can tell us what you see in that final fusillade.
I see him hit me with a punch. He missed the punch. Good body shot.
One body shot got it.
He hit me with, it wasn't nothing on that good hook. Miss. These are not solid shots. Miss. My hands up. He missed four shots in a row. And he stopped the fight. He missed four shots in a row and he stopped the fight.
Let me ask you this. The referee said that he told both fighters.
Oh, man, look at that ref.
The referee said that before the fight, he told both fighters.
If I'm hurt, take a knee.
Take a knee.
If I wasn't defending myself, I would have took a knee.
It occurred to you at that moment that you could have taken a knee?
It occurred to me the whole fight that if I was ever in that, had the round continued, the round before, had it been a minute left in that round, maybe I would have took a knee.
Will you try to protest the end of this fight and try to get a rematch?
Man. Be filing with the IBF immediately to protest this decision by the referee.
I was running away with the fight.
He was winning almost every round of
this
fight.
I was running away with the fight.
He was dominating the fight.
How can you stop the champion like that?
The referee had no right to stop the fight at the time. We will demand an immediate rematch, and hopefully the IBF will give justice to this man.
Thank you very much.
What do you think?
Jim.
Larry, let's turn to our favorite.